As to the position of Christianity, let it be stated without any hesitation or equivocation that its divine origin is unconditionally acknowledged, that the sonship and divinity of Jesus Christ are fearlessly asserted, that the divine inspiration of the gospel is fully recognized.
Fully recognized. Divine inspiration of the gospel is fully recognized.
Hello, Bezel 333. That was a younger Dr. David Young back in the 1990s leading a seminar on how Baha'is should talk with Christians in order to convert them to the Baha'i religion.
David now serves on the Baha'i National Spiritual Assembly of the United States. It's one of roughly 200 nations having national spiritual assemblies. From these assemblies are elected the supreme governing authority of the Baha'i faith, who convene at the Universal Hall of Justice, located, not surprisingly, in Haifa, Israel, nestled up against Mount Carmel. The 9-member council is made up of all men, as women are not allowed to hold the position, which is quite odd for a religion claiming to promote gender equality. Now, this seminar is taken from a handbook that David Young produced called Teaching Christians More Effectively. The goal of this seminar is twofold. First, to build a new world order with a one world religion.
Ultimately, our enthusiasm won't build the world order of Baha'u'llah. Our knowledge won't build the world order of Baha'u'llah. Our skills in applying what we understand of this faith, this will build the world order. All is necessary. Knowledge is wonderful. Inspiration is wonderful. But skills are necessary.
The second is this: to convince Christians that when they worship Jesus, they are really worshiping the latest manifestation of God, namely Baha'u'llah.
What do we have to offer our fellow believers in Christ? Is it not a closer relationship with their Lord, Jesus the Christ, whose name is Baha'u'llah? Christianity is the Baha'i faith. The Baha'i faith is Christianity.
Now, I want to take issue in the way in which David, who represents the Baha'i faith, handles the Bible. This exercise will serve to underscore the importance of defining our terms when talking to anyone about what the Bible actually teaches.
The foundations of all the divine prophets and holy books are one. The difference among them is one of terminology only.
So when the Bible says that in Jesus all the fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily, and the Quran says that Jesus, the Son of Mary, was only a messenger of God, well, that's just a simple case of differing terminology. Well, I call that a clear contradiction.
Go ahead, David. Do you want to read the commentary?
Therefore, Christianity is our religion too, and we are fellow believers in Christ and the Bible. The differences between Baha'is and Christians are in terminology only, which can be resolved by reinterpretation of the Bible for Christians to demonstrate the common foundation of Christianity and the Baha'i faith.
If Christianity were your religion too, then you would be a Christian and not a Baha'i. Our differences are not a matter of reinterpretation, they're a matter of proper interpretation. And what we'll find is that David ignores two fundamental hermeneutical rules: context and genre. Failing to use them correctly will always result in a deficient understanding of the Word of God as found in the Old and New Testaments.
Then he, Abdu'l-Bahá, explained the puzzling question of the Trinity and demonstrated from both a scientific and religious standpoint that Trinity not only exists in every religion, but in philosophy as well. In the Mosaic dispensation, there was the Elohim, the I Am, the burning bush, and Moses.
Okay, the Elohim, the I Am, the burning bush, and Moses? Well, that's four, David.
In Christianity, the Father, the Holy Ghost, and the Son. In Islam, Allah, Gabriel, and Muhammad.
Muhammad never claimed equality with God. The angel Gabriel is never said to be of the same substance as God. But in Christianity, Jesus does claim equality with God. After healing a man on the Sabbath in John chapter 5, Jesus says to the Pharisees, "My Father is working until now, and I myself am working. For this reason, therefore, the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him, because he not only was breaking the Sabbath, but also was calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God." Jesus does claim to share the same substance and the same glory as the Father has and deserves. Remember the words of the prophet Isaiah in chapter 42. We read there, "I am the Lord, that is my name. I will not give my glory to another." Yet, in John 17, Jesus speaks of sharing in the glory of the Father. He says, "I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work which you had given me to do. Now, Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory in which I had with you before the world was." You see, this kind of category confusion and the warm fusion of contradictory ideas are rife in the Baha'i religion.
Regarding being reborn in faith, man must be born again. As the babe is born into the light of this physical world, so must the physical and intellectual man be born into the light of the world of divinity.
So you Baha'is, are you born again?
Yes. Yeah.
Yes, we're born again. Our own writings say the same thing. In fact, you could say every time you encounter the Word of God, you're born again. Right? Okay.
Guys, we need to define our terms here. What does a Baha'i mean when he talks about being born again? Well, this is from Abdul Baha in London, page 87. By the way, this is the son of Bahá'u'lláh. He says, "Man's true second birth occurs when he is freed from all material things, for he is only free who is not captive to his desires." Now, I ask you, is this what Christianity teaches regarding the second birth? Well, let's go to the scriptures. Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 2, "And you, who were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince and power of the air, of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience, among whom we too all formerly lived in the lust of the flesh, indulging in the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. But God, being rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our sins and trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved." We're talking about a new nature that can receive the things of God. This is what Jesus meant when he told Nicodemus that unless a man is born again, born of water and the Spirit, remember, he cannot see the kingdom of heaven. He says to Nicodemus, "And you are a teacher of Israel, and you don't understand these things?" Well, he says this because the Hebrew scriptures tell this same story very plainly. Take a look at Ezekiel 36. "I will take you from the nations, gather you from all the lands, and bring you into your own land. Then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and all your idols. Moreover, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh." That is what being born again is all about. Being cleansed of our sins and being given a new heart, having been given a new heart that can receive the things of God, namely the gospel of Jesus Christ, that he died for sinners such as me. That's a far cry from being freed from material things.
Regarding justification by faith, "We are cognizant of thy righteous deeds, though they shall avail thee nothing. For the whole object of such righteousness is but recognition of God thy Lord and undoubted faith in the words revealed by him."
In other words, the way that one's sins are forgiven, that one stands in right relationship to the Lord, to God, is by your faith. That is in our own writings. It's in all the writings of all the scriptures.
Now, I agree that the Bible does say that we are justified by faith. No problem there. Romans 3:28. "For we maintain that a man is justified by faith." The question is, faith in what? Or whom, more specifically? Romans 5:1. "Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ." Now, the passage continues. For while we were still helpless, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will hardly die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good man someone would dare even to die. But God demonstrates his own love towards us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Baha'u'llah did not die for anyone. He just died, and he's still dead to this very day. We are justified by faith. But the full formula for the Christian is that we are justified by God's grace alone, through faith alone, on account of the person and work of Jesus the Christ alone. If a Baha'i can say that, then he or she is no longer a Baha'i, but is now a Christian.
This is John the Baptist, and he's talking about how the one who would come after him is greater than he. He's not fit to carry the sandals of he who would come after. Because they just ask him, are you Elijah? Are you the Messiah? He says, no, I'm not even fit to carry the sandals of the one who will come after. He will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. So how should a Christian be baptized? With fire. How do you understand that, my fellow believer in Christ?
David, you're missing the context here. This is the problem. This is the problem. What does John the Baptist say? As for me, I baptize you with water for repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, and I'm not fit to remove his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. But John continues and distinguishes between the Holy Spirit and fire. In the very next verse, he says, the winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clear his threshing floor, and will gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. You see, Christians are to be baptized the way that Jesus commanded his people to be baptized. Christians are to be baptized with water, doesn't matter on the amount of water, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, which is a visible sign of an invisible reality, namely being cleansed of our sins and having been born again. Okay, David is now going to attempt to counter the Christian claim that the canon of divinely inspired scripture contained within the Old and New Testament is complete and closed.
This is the argument that you can't, Baha'u'llah cannot, you Baha'is cannot add to the New Testament.
But we find in Revelations, which was written between 95 and 96 AD, and Galatians, which was written between 50 and 60 AD, and Matthew, were written well before the Gospel of John in 130 AD, the 2nd Peter in 150 AD, or James in 200 AD, 1 Timothy in 185 AD, and 2 Timothy in 185 AD. And other books of the Bible. Therefore, the New Testament contains much revelation revealed after the admonitions in Revelations and Galatians and Matthew.
Now, I'm sorry, David, but no respectable textual scholar, not even the liberal ones, will say that any of the New Testament documents were written after the end of the first century. This statement is factually fallacious and fails to make the case that David is trying to prove. You know, I've got a lot more to say about this, but I think just because it would be too long of a video, I'm going to chop it up and I'm going to do two parts. So my next video will continue this conversation about this seminar that David Young is presenting and showing the inconsistencies that he is presenting to his people, interested Baha'is. Let me leave you with one scripture as we end up. Let me swap glasses so I can read the finer print. You see, for Christianity, it's all about Jesus, not Jesus just being one more manifestation of God, but the very God and man who walked this earth in the first century. Let me read this to you. This is from Philippians chapter 2. Therefore, God has highly exalted him, Jesus, and bestowed on him, Jesus, the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, not just the eternal spirit or God, but Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. You see, this is our disagreement with our Baha'i friends. It's not that God has sent different manifestations of himself throughout human history, and now our current one is Bahá'u'lláh, who, by the way, has lived and died. He came out of, it's an offshoot of Islam, right? The Bab. He was a follower of the Bab who broke off from Islam, tried to abolish some of the laws, got in trouble. It's not a really good idea to do that with Islam. They ended up killing him, murdering him, I believe. And then Bahá'u'lláh decides he's the one that the Bab foretold would come and be the return of Jesus Christ. Folks, the Bible is sufficient. You just need to know that. And I'm going to prove that more and more as we continue on in part two of our study, very quick study, of the Baha'i religion. See you next time.